Father, we thank you for gathering us this day in the presence of your Son. For he has promised that where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst of it. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus, and give you the worship, the praise, the honor, and the glory that belongs only to you. As we gather this morning, we pray, Lord, that you would open up our eyes and our ears and our hearts to receive from you, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you be our teacher, so that the words of my mouth and the taste of our hearts may be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. What we find in Psalm 4 is this. We read in Psalm 4, verse 5, offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. Offer right sacrifices. Did you realize that that is a command, and it's a command that is not restricted to the Old Testament? Christians, too, are called to offer right sacrifices. So today I want us to consider the fact that we're called to offer sacrifices, and I want us to consider what kind of sacrifices we're called to offer. But before I get into those, I wanted to consider two things. First of all, if we're going to talk about sacrifices that are made in the Christian life, we need to understand that we may in fact have to offer many different kinds of sacrifices, but none of those sacrifices have to do with making us right before the Father. Why? Because there is only one atoning sacrifice, and that is Jesus Christ on the cross. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is the one who's made us right with the Father. He is the one that's given us eternal life. When we put our faith in that sacrifice which the Father has provided on our behalf, we are saved. So the sacrifices we're going to talk about today are not sacrifices of atonement that make us right with the Father. We make those sacrifices because we've been made right, not because we need to be making ourselves right. What that means, too, is that the sacrifices that we will be making are not the kind of sacrifices where we take an animal and kill it and put it on an altar. That's not what we're looking at. Because again, the blood sacrifice, the life for life, has already been taken care of through the shed blood of Jesus. By his wounds, we are healed. He became sin, who knew no sin, for us, that we would be the righteousness of God in him. So when we're talking about sacrifices then, let us remember that we're not talking about the atonement. We're talking about other things that come as a result of what God has done for us. Now, that being said, I do want us to see that there is one way in which these sacrifices we will make is similar to what we see in the Old Testament. And we find that in 2 Samuel. In 2 Samuel, we find that David will not accept the bulls or the wood as charity. He insists on paying for it. Why? Because he says, I will not offer this to God as if it costs me nothing. Every sacrifice that we make will cost us something. Something has to die. We have to let go of something. I want you to keep that in mind as we consider the sacrifices of the Christian life. And really, when we consider the sacrifices of the Christian life, there are three that I want us to consider. There are more that we find in the New Testament, but all of them basically orbit these three. In Romans 12:1, we learn that we're called to sacrifice our bodies. In Hebrews 13, we find two sacrifices. We're called to sacrifice the sacrifice of praise, and we're also called to sacrifice by sharing and giving to others. So let's consider these three, and let's consider what it cost us, and let's consider what we're moving into when we offer these sacrifices. The first one I want us to consider, because it really is all-encompassing, is the one we find in Romans 12:1. In Romans 12:1, we find that St. Paul writes by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit the following. He says, I urge you, brethren, in view of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. With these words, St. Paul calls the Christian to present their bodies as a living sacrifice. Now, what does that mean? Well, St. Paul is using imagery from the temple. And in the temple, when you brought the body of an animal to the altar, once you gave that body over, it was no longer yours. It belonged to God. That is what St. Paul is saying to us. That's what the Holy Spirit is telling us. We're not here to kill our bodies. We're a living sacrifice. But nevertheless, when we come before the altar and we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, what we're saying to God is, from now on, you're in charge. My body's not my own. See, that's important, because very often when people come to Christ, when they get saved, they ask, all right, Lord, what do you want from me? And sometimes we get super spiritual and we think, well, he wants us to go do something like go to Africa right now. Or he wants us to go do something like give up our money and whatever. And he may actually call you to do that at some point. But actually, God is very practical. God says, I want your body. Because if he has your body, he has everything in your body. He has your mind. He has your spirit. He has your soul. He has everything. From now on, you are not living by your own agenda. From now on, you're not living for the world. From now on, you are not available for Satan or for the flesh. From now on, you are a temple of the Holy Spirit, and that from God. You're not your own. You are purchased with a price, and you will honor God in your body. What does that cost us? It cost us governing ourselves. It cost us living for ourselves. It cost us selfishness. We have to give all that up. It has to die. From now on, we're not living by our own agenda, but by the Lord's agenda. When we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, then, we're giving God everything. Everything. There's nothing left out. We're completely His. And it costs us living according to our own wants, wishes, and desires. Because now we're living for Him. That's the cost. And notice in the gospel that Jesus very often is telling these three people who he talks to that he can count the cost. Giving yourself to him will cost you sovereignty over your own life. Because now you're living for him. He's the Lord and you're not. And from now on, you're living for his kingdom and you're not here to build your own. That's the first sacrifice. It's all encompassing. You win, Lord. I'm completely yours. And I'm not here for me. I'm here for you. Now, the second sacrifice that we're called to is a sacrifice of praise. A sacrifice of praise. What does that cost us? Well, let me tell you what it costs us. It costs us a grumbling and complaining spirit. See, very often, when you get out of bed, or when you're at work, what we find ourselves doing from time to time, actually more often than we like to admit, we grumble and complain about things. We grumble and complain about our co-workers. We grumble and complain about the boss. We grumble and complain about Package Monday. We grumble and complain about this, that, and the other thing. What God is calling us to is praise. Praise. Which means giving God the worship and the glory and speaking out loudly and enthusiastically all the great things that He has done. When we wake up in the morning, we're called to wake up and give Him the praise and the worship and the glory. And that means thanking God for salvation, thanking Jesus for His goodness, thanking Him for His grace, His mercy, His favor, His love, everything He's given us, the Holy Spirit, salvation. There's nothing that we shouldn't be praising Him for. When you get up in the morning, you should be praising and thanking Him for your family, for the fact you have a roof over your head, for the clothing that you're wearing, for the shower you get to take. Now, people my time don't realize it, but we should even be thanking God for indoor toilets. Praise God. Especially praise Him when it's 40 below outside. Praise Him. But instead, we get up. We have on our mind what we have to do today right away, and we start grumbling and complaining about, well, I can't believe that I have to go take care of this again, or I can't believe I got to do that, or I can't believe I got to do this. If we would give God glory and praise Him, we would finally put to death that grumbling, complaining spirit. Why? Because you cannot be praising Jesus for very long and keep a grumbling and complaining and depressed spirit. It can't stay. It's got to go. That's important for us to see. Because did you realize that grumbling, complaining is a sin? It is. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're reminded that grumbling is one reason why many of the Israelites did not enter into the land. They didn't enter into the land because grumbling against God, grumbling, complaining about your situation, is actually unbelief. You're not believing that God can take care of this. You're not believing that He's got you well in hand. You're not believing that His power can overcome everything. You're not believing that He overcomes and He has given you the power to overcome. You're not believing that when you're grumbling and complaining. Instead, you're trying to take control. Maybe trying to get even. And you're whining when you should be praising. And frankly, and we probably all know people like this, and sometimes we might even been that ourselves. There are some people that take a perverse pleasure in grumbling and complaining. You ever see that? People with a perverse pleasure in grumbling and complaining. Seems like that's the only thing they can do. And when they do that, they can't see the blessings. And when you can't see the blessings, you can't see God. I'll give you one example. Some of you probably heard this already, but you know, there was a farmer named Olin. And whenever he went to the family reunions, it was a dark cloud that just hovered over everybody. Because he was constantly complaining about how bad farming was. Always too much rain, not enough rain. Always too many weeds, not enough weeds. And the guy just went on like that. But one day his nephew was so tired of it that he went home and he saw the paper that Uncle Olin, well, his entire township had a bumper crop. So he cut that out and he saved it for the next family reunion. And sure enough, when he got there, Olin was doing the same thing, grumbling and complaining about how bad things were. They took out that article, put it right down on the table and said, Uncle Olin, you had a bumper crop. You have nothing to complain about. And without missing a beat, Olin said, yeah, but those good years are so tough on the soil. They take a perverse pleasure in grumbling and complaining. Why? Unfortunately, that plays into pride and self-righteousness. We grumble and complain about other people, makes us feel better about ourselves. We don't have any reason to feel better about ourselves that way. But we do. That's a sin. What's the cure for that? Praise the Lord. Give Him the glory. Focus on heavenly things, not on the things on the earth. It says in Scripture, set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden in Christ. When Christ appears, then you will appear with him also in glory. Set your mind on the things that are above. And how do you do that? Through praise. I want to say this too, for the benefit of those of you who aren't religious. Praising God can get noisy. It can get loud. It can get a little rambunctious. Let me say right now, that's okay. People are not having a connection. They're just praising the Lord. And it may do us well to actually get out of our little boxes sometimes and go ahead and shout and praise and give glory to Jesus. Even when our religion side says, well, I don't have to, yeah. See, I want to understand that praise is not giving God his all time. That was a problem. That's not what praise is. Praise is like, woo! Praise the Lord! Give God the glory. Now you don't have to do that in church, go home and do that. But you can do it anywhere, but you need to start praising him, because that's when you break those bondages off of grumbling, complaining, and focusing on the world, just focusing on heaven and on what God has for you. Feel free to get loud. God never said that you have to be silent as little church lights. Praise him. Give him the glory. In the Bible, that word praise means get loud so that the whole neighborhood hears. That's sometimes in Jerusalem, it was written that they get so loud that the ground would begin to shake. That's how loud they got. It's like a football stadium. You ever be in a football stadium? People are really, really shouting and carrying on with their football team, and the place begins to shake because people are screaming. You know, it's a shame that we'll do that for a football team, but we won't do that for God. We can't do it. We just direct it in the wrong place. What's God calling us to? A sacrifice of praise. And that means dying to a grumbling, complaining spirit. And we die to it, cost us that. It costs us that unholy pleasure. We die to it by praising and glorifying him and focusing on heaven and not on the things of the earth. Now finally, he calls us to a sacrifice that is about giving and sharing with others. What does that cost us? Selfishness, greed, and it also costs us the fear of not having. And I just want to focus on the fear of not having for a moment, because that seems to be the one that really has people from time to time. Very often, what keeps us from giving generously and helping other people isn't necessarily because of greed, isn't necessarily because of selfish, although there's a little bit of that in all of us. It's because we're afraid. We're afraid that we won't have. We're afraid that we'll have a need for that later on. We'll give it away, and we won't have what we need. There's a way to die to that, and that is to give generously. Die to the fear of not having by doing exactly what the fear doesn't want you to do. And that's give generously. Why? Because God's made a promise. Our God will provide all our needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. That's a promise. And if you will give out generously to those in need, you will find that you will not be in need. Doesn't mean that you're going to have a mansion. God never promised you a mansion on earth. There's a mansion in heaven waiting for you. But he never promised you a mansion on earth. But if you will give out what he has given you, you will find yourself not in need. The way to break the spirit of fear in your life, and the way to break the spirit of selfishness and greed, is go ahead and do what your emotions are telling you not to do. Give it out. And the more you give out, the more that thing dies. That's the sacrifice given. I'm called to do that. And so today, let's see what these three sacrifices do. We're called to sacrifice our bodies to the Lord, which means He gets complete control. We die to selfishness, we live for Him. We're called to sacrifice praise, which means that we die to grumbling and complaining, or we die to anxiety and fear, and we give ourselves over to giving Him glory. And then we're called to share. That means dying in the fear of not having the selfishness. All the sacrifices we're called to really are about one thing. Dying to sin. Dying to the flesh. And living in the new birth that the Father has given us through the Holy Spirit. Today then, let us remember that we're called to give right sacrifices. Those sacrifices are really about dying to the things in this earth and dying to our flesh so we may live for God and share His glory with others. Let's offer these right sacrifices. Put our trust in the Lord. And we will see the blessings of the King entering not only in our lives, but in the lives of others. In Jesus' name. All right, we'll sing our next hymn, 99, in the red hymn.